So the issue of quality, one is, as we discussed about the faculty shortages, and the other issue that we discussed is about how teaching is understood by the teachers in the classroom. Also, there is a gap between teaching and research. So research and excellence are very crucial to building the global reputation of higher education institutions. There is need, therefore, to establish better links between teaching and research. The quality of doctoral students is also very important. We need to have good doctoral students because the future of the quality of the higher education institutions depends on these doctoral level students who may become the higher education faculty in the future. But what we find is that sometimes the doctorate is the only research a higher education faculty has ever undertaken. Mostly, many of the higher education faculty in Indian classrooms at the undergraduate level, they do not have experience in doctoral level research, or if they have, that is the only research they have ever undertaken. So if we look at the global trend where the research is being seen increasingly integrated into undergrad teaching, the scenario is completely different in Indian classrooms. There is also lack of disciplinary and methodological expertise amongst the faculty who are the guides, research supervisors, and therefore that impacts the quality of research being undertaken. The problem is also with the accountability measures by the regulators and the assessors, because when the regulator or assessor want to look at the number of theses produced or the number of research publications produced, automatically the shift is now the focus shifts from the quality of the material or the quality of the work, quality of research, to producing more of it in terms of numbers. So the shift from quality to quantity in terms of research is detrimental to the quality of the higher education, overall quality of higher education. That has led to proliferation of spurious journals, bad quality research. So there may be, it may seem that a lot of research is happening and in terms of numbers, but actual quality of research may be very poor. So which the literature it is called as the pseudo research culture is being encouraged by the regulators in if they focus too much on the quantity rather than quality of research. And also, so linking research grants with accreditation outcomes is one way in which accreditors and assessors want to encourage the quality of research in higher education institutions. But the question remains, to what extent has it really impacted the quality of research in the institutions? So let me give you some questions to discuss amongst yourselves. You can write to me also. If linking research grants with accreditation outcomes of the higher education institutions can improve the quality of research and teaching learning, if this proposition is made, how would you respond to this proposition? You can give your arguments in favor of this proposition. And what should be done to encourage research by faculty members? Because not many faculty are seem to be involved in the research. If they are not, then what can be done to encourage the research by faculty members? And what could be the strategies to really integrate this research and teaching into in undergraduate education? Given you have to reflect on these questions, given the circumstances in which you work, the kind of higher education institutions you work with. So friends, now we will discuss about the professionalization of teachers and academics in higher education. You must have seen that accreditors, when they go to the higher education institutions, they look for the number of publications or the researches undertaken by the higher education faculty, which is an aspect of professionalization of higher education academics. Professionalization as a term has both descriptive and prescriptive usage. those researchers who seek to define characteristics of a profession accept the descriptive usage of the term. And this usage assumes that each profession has a distinguishing characteristic which has markers of distinction amongst different profession. So at the same time, there are emerging professions or there are semi or quasi professions which are at the continuum. So at the one level, you have these semi, quasi or emerging professions, and the at the other extreme, you have the professions which have very defined characteristics. So professions are at the position of achieving some desired state. The usage unfolds in various ways, such as when the governments define or remind the practitioners of an occupation, for example, higher education academics, in the context of this work that we are undertaking at the Center for Policy Research in Higher Education, that their responsibilities so as to establish the basis of the acceptance of the reforms and policies. So the researchers concerned with the prescriptive criteria look for the way in which the term is used rather than search for any predefined term. Now, in case of the recommendations for merit-based selection of teachers, the National Commission of Teachers in 1985, when it said that there has to be merit-based selection of teachers, it was exactly trying to do these things in terms looking at making the prescriptive usage of the term professionalization. Establishment of academic staff colleges following the recommendations of the National Policy of Education for in-service training of teachers, and again the merit-based selection of teaching cadre in the NPE 1986. The launch of a national eligibility test in 1989 on the recommendations of the Mehrotra Committee report was again a step with an intention to recruit quality teachers and a step towards professionalization of teachers in higher education. The CAPE Committee on the Autonomy of Higher Education Institutions in 2005 recommended that NET examination be made compulsory for those without a PhD, and that periodic in-service training of teachers must be made compulsory. Academic performance indicators were launched by the University Grants Commission in India in 2010 under the performance-based appraisal systems. So these are the various ways in which the policy makers, they define what should go into the profession of teaching in higher education. At the same time, there's something called the scholarship of teaching and learning. The professional discipline practice with teaching as a profession and research and knowledge base in the discipline of teaching and learning define the scholarship of teaching. Now, in many parts of the globe, higher education institutions value research in disciplinary pedagogy, teaching learning as much as disciplinary study itself. So, there's so much research on teaching pedagogy that many times there is a tension that research on teaching takes the whole lot of the higher education institutional mandate. However, on the contrary, in India, if we see that teaching crowds out research, so there is generally not enough research happening in Indian higher education institutions generally. At the same time, the research on teaching is also absent. Most of the higher education institutions in India are teaching intensive, and there is also no pedagogical qualification for the teachers who are entering the higher education institutions. Whatever professional development in terms of pedagogic understanding in higher education institution a teacher develops in the course of practice or through the in-service professional development programs. Expectations from the higher education institutions has now again become such that the higher education institution should be interdisciplinary. There is shift in the focus from the specialized institutional mandate to becoming multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary institutions. And in this scenario, the focus on the scholarship of teaching and learning in higher education becomes important.